Hi, I'm Dr. Cameron Venek. I'm a researcher with the Dunlap Institute for Astronomy and Astrophysics. My research specialty is cosmic magnetism, which I study using radio astronomy. The interstellar medium is essentially all of the stuff that exists in the volume of space between the stars in our galaxy. The name basically comes from medium for, well, stuff, and interstellar, the area between the stars. It's predominantly a mixture of gas, a very, very thin gas, about 10 billion billion times thinner than the air on Earth. So it's a mixture of incredibly thin gas, plasma, which is gas that has had some of the electrons knocked off that are floating around separately, as well as dust, small collections of molecules. And so this collection of dust, gas, and plasma floats independently of the stars in the volume of space of the entire galaxy. And even though it's very, very thin, it amounts to a very large amount of material overall. Space is big after all. It's about 1 billion suns worth of material spread out across the entire galaxy. The interstellar medium has a lot of rich complexity to it. There are parts that are hot, there are parts that are very cold, there are parts that are warm, although warm by astronomer standards is still several thousand degrees. It has a lot of very interesting and complicated behavior. There's turbulence and mixing, there's cloud collapse to form new stars, and there's exploding shockwaves from supernovae and other events. So there's a lot going on. And in addition, it's all traced through with magnetic fields. That's a really tricky question because magnetic fields aren't made of something else. It's not something that you can really describe in relation to something else because it's one of the fundamental ingredients of the universe. It's essentially this immaterial thing that's spread out through the entirety of space that causes forces to happen in things that are magnetically reactive, mainly permanent magnetized materials and electric charges. So if you've ever experienced the force from holding two magnets next to each other and having them attract or repel each other, what you're experiencing is the magnetic field from one magnet creating a force in the other magnet. Each magnet produces its own magnetic field in this volume of space around it, and that magnetic field is what causes the force on the other objects. So there's two ways of producing magnetic fields. The first one is through permanent magnets, which are certain kinds of materials that under some conditions carry a magnetic field around themselves. And so this is what we're used to in our day-to-day lives with iron or neodymium magnets. But in outer space, we don't really have any solid materials that would act as a permanent magnet. And so we must rely on the second method of generating magnetic fields, which is electric currents moving through conductive materials. And so in the interstellar medium, the conductive material is the plasma that exists throughout. Plasma is a very, very good conductor. So the question then is, where do the electric currents come from? And there's a couple of different physical processes that can generate electric currents in the interstellar medium. But these days, in the modern universe, it's actually dominated by electric induction, where conductive material moves through a magnetic field. When the material moves through a magnetic field, it produces electric currents. Then, as I said, these electric currents produce magnetic fields. So the whole thing forms a feedback loop where the moving material generates electric currents, the electric currents generate the magnetic field, the magnetic field interacts with the moving material to generate more currents. So this is called a magnetic dynamo, and we observe these to happen in a number of different astrophysical environments. We see it in the Sun and in other stars. We see it in the interstellar medium. And we even see it on Earth, where the conductive material is not plasma, but the molten metal in the core of the Earth. So on Earth, we have access to sensors called magnetometers, which are able to measure the magnetic field locally wherever we put the sensor. But in space, that's not really an option. And so instead, we have to rely on a number of different physical processes where the magnetic field either causes light to exist or affects the light in a way that's measurable. Most of these physical processes tend to affect the polarization of light. Polarization is a property of light that is akin to an orientation. You can think of light traveling in some direction, and it has an orientation associated with it as it travels. It could be vertically oriented, it could be horizontally oriented, or slanted at some arbitrary angle. There are several physical processes where the magnetic field can either cause polarization to exist in light or can affect the polarization that already exists in light. And so by measuring the polarization properties, we can then infer something about the physical processes and the magnetic fields that cause them. Some of these processes occur most strongly with radio emission, and so we can observe them most easily using radio astronomy. So I think the one that I've found most interesting has been the Milky Way galaxy as a whole. And so my very first cosmic magnetism research project was trying to understand the structure of the magnetic field on the scale of the entire Milky Way galaxy. So I was fascinated by the idea that not only does the interstellar medium within the Milky Way galaxy have its own magnetic field, but that magnetic field is structured and coherent on scales of the entire galaxy, of entire spiral arms, covering thousands and thousands of light years. And this coherent structure has emerged over billions of years of the galaxy rotating around.